The king has returned. Marc Marquez has won again here in Germany, but more importantly, won his first race back since, of course, that horrific injury, almost a career ender last July. I'm Steve Day, joined by Simon Crafar. The top three we'll be hearing from shortly with Matt Burt as well. Marc Marquez, the winner here today. Miguel Oliveira on the podium again in second, and the world championship leader Fabio Quartararo with a third. But first, Simon, I have to get your thoughts on the Marc Marquez win. We knew he had the speed, but the way he executed that race today, as the rain started to fall, he saw his opportunity, he grabbed it with both hands, and what a sporting story we've just witnessed.
Yeah, I couldn't agree with more with how you just put it. The thing Mark did was, first of all, he had no advantage here at all. It's just that he had less of a disadvantage. The Honda at the moment is behind, you know. And he saw the opportunity, like you said, and executed everything he did today beautifully. The start, he only had Aleix behind him, so it didn't take long for him to battle past Aleix, and the others struggled more to get past Aleix. And he just took every opportunity. That bit of rain, he made the gap that made it so hard for Oliveira, who was just as fast today as him. But I've got to say, respect to be able to do. I've got nothing but admiration for what he did today, you know. He made his bike. He did it, you know. It was absolutely fantastic.
And the way he was pushing just as the rain started to fall, I mean, this was the early stages where he was putting a few moves on Aleix Espargaró. And credit to Aleix on the Aprilia, because he was giving it back to him in the first few laps.
You know, the thing about Aleix is, I mean, we talk about the Aprilia all the time, how it's come on and it's improving, and they're there every weekend, they're competitive. But Aleix has the hunger as well and the ability to run with the boys at the front. So hats off, I agree.
The rain started to fall at this point. We wondered whether it was going to pour down. Mark saw the opportunity and just bolted, putting in some laps and ultimately unstoppable. He did come under some late pressure from Miguel Oliveira, who, again, you can't really fault his performance, other than perhaps the start maybe just struggling behind some of those Ducatis in the early stages.
Completely. It was the start that blew it for Miguel, plus, you know, getting stuck behind a few guys. Plus, like we said, that few raindrops, Mark managed to pull a gap, which at this level is nigh on impossible. If the guy's the same speed as you, you saw how hard it was for Oliveira. Miguel, here he is on screen now. How hard it was for him to pull Mark back in. It was a proper battle of wills, and I think ran out of tyre. Both of them ran out of tyre at the end, didn't they? So, yeah, amazing.
What we do have to say about Miguel Oliveira is, and certainly what we've seen based on the last three races, Simon, is that he is the real deal. I mean, we already knew the class of Miguel Oliveira, but the performances in his last three races have been utterly flawless.
Yeah, stunning. And he doesn't make mistakes. I think he's looking in. He's a nightmare to race against because he's so mentally strong, as his opponent was today, Mark. And he just doesn't give other people a chance, you know, make a mistake, or he's flawless, like you said.
Championships are made of points, of course, and you need to finish the days where that doesn't quite go to plan, perhaps on the podium. Today, Fabio Quartararo managed to find the podium after a tricky start where he got mired back in the pack. He had to do some work on the overtaking. Ultimately, he seems really pleased when he was speaking to you with 16 precious points.
I felt he was, because I've been listening to his debriefs, listening to Mayo Marigali over the weekend, and they both said he wasn't that comfortable. You know, he said it a few times over the weekend. The other Yamahas weren't near him. And for him to salvage a podium today, I think shows, I mentioned it before, how rounded he is now. He's a proper championship threat. I think you mentioned it in Parc Fermé, how a bad day for Fabio now is third. You know, he's very, very good. Or fourth round there, which is amazing.
Yeah, he's going to take a 22-point lead into Assen next week, a circuit that not just he loves, but absolutely everyone loves. Here are all of his overtaking manoeuvres on Jack. Jack and the Ducatis in general will be pretty disappointed. I think that both Jack and Zarco quite clearly suffered with tyre drop-off in the latter stages. Pecco Bagnaia, on the other hand, coming through from 10th on the grid, had plenty of tyre left, and he would have probably wanted about another six or seven laps.
Pecco picked it as well. I listened to his debrief last night, and he said, yeah, we didn't do anything qualifying. All my laps were cancelled, but I have the pace. And I was like, ooh. And he showed it.
Before we hear from the top three, what a ride from Brad Binder. 13th on the grid. Considering this is his first time here on a MotoGP bike, and as Matt said in commentary on Friday, he was stone last.
Yeah, he's Sunday man Brad. That's why we all call him that. Truly awesome.
Here
run through. Yeah.
Some of his moves were just spectacular today. I mean, they didn't all come off either, so he had to work very hard for the fourth, especially around a circuit that's so difficult to overtake.
And so easy to fall down on, you know, make a mistake. Yeah, Brad, absolutely awesome. If you look at his race pace, having to come through that traffic, I'm sure he wouldn't be far off the very front guys, you know, if he had the start and a better position, you know, start position.
And you can just see there in that shot, Joan Mir. Now, it looks as though it was all too little too late in terms of finding the right setup for Joan Mir. He was struggling all weekend. I mean, if you're 16th on the grid, it's always going to be hard in Germany, but his rhythm was pretty good.
Yeah, very good. That's why I said to Shinichi Sahara on the grid that normally your boys always come through on the Suzukis, but I have no idea if they can do it today, because they haven't quite shown it, have they? You know, the pace of, for example, Mark, Oliveira, who else, even Jack, Zarco, they were all a level above coming into the race, favourites. But again, Joan Mir rode awesome.
Aleix Bagro in the end, despite leading in the early stages, went across the line in seventh. It's still another great result for the team as they try to make baby steps forward. I'm sure that Aleix will be a bit disappointed. It didn't quite go his way, though.
I think that, you know, in a few days, he looked back on it and go, he did pretty well, you know. And I'd just like to repeat, it's not just Aprilia that's impressed me. It is Aleix, his hunger and his ability, you know. So I think there's more to come.
Despite the emotions of Marc Marquez winning here and the true heroic performance from him, you asked Alberto early in the weekend whether or not this circuit was hiding or masking the issues of the Honda. From what you've seen this weekend, do you think they have genuinely found something, or is it just Mark and this circuit?
Just listening to whispers and trying to understand, I think they made a little step electronic-wise to help that lack of grip entry and exit. The aero package, maybe a little step. I don't think it's enough. I think that it'll be Yamahas and KTMs, maybe Suzuki's at Assen. I genuinely do.
Okay, well, let's now cross over to Matt. I believe he's with the World Championship leader. 22 points he'll take into Assen, and I'm sure he's delighted with that. Fabio Quartararo is with Matt.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Steve. Just having a quick chat with Fabio off camera. Yeah, he's very happy with third place. Fabio, it's normally bronze for third, but you've just said it's like gold today, the 16 points you took for the championship in a difficult race after a difficult weekend. You've got to be super happy to increase your lead in the World Championship as well.
Yes, thank you very much. That was a tough race. I mean, we struggled all the weekend, and with the team we were quite clear. I mean, this morning we saw that the pace was good, but not for the victory. We saw Miguel and Mark were just faster than us. And not a lot, 2-3 tenths, but on the race I make a bad start. I make a good start, but not good first corner. And they just go away, and my pace was just 2 tenths or three slower than them. And with the team, we say first goal is try to finish in front of the Ducatis, and then try to finish on the podium. And this is what we did, and yeah, so happy for this podium.
We know how close it is in MotoGP these days. So you just said there you're missing those 2 or 3 tenths, which is nothing, but it can be so big when the lap times are so close. So what was the difference? What were those 2 tenths that you were missing throughout this weekend?
I think that 1.5 tenths was on corner 7. I mean, our bike was not turning in that corner. And this morning I was quite clear with the team. I say, if we are able to fight for something, there will be tough. And I was every time behind the riders, and this corner I lose 1.5 tenths all the time, or 2. So there was a weak point for us. And then the bike was okay, but in that track, you know, it's totally different, and we didn't feel great. I mean, all the race I was not feeling good, and we finished in P3, so that's amazing.
Always difficult when the small spots of rain start to fall on your visor. I mean, I think in Le Mans you said afterwards it was full send. It looked like you went full send when those spots of rain started to fall here. Yes. As well.
Yes. I was in that mood, you know, like I need to send it, and and at that time was not easy to overtake like Le Mans. This track is so difficult, but I was behind the riders. Like, it's the moment to overtake, and Mark was so fast. And in that moment, I said, it's the moment to push, to try to be in front of these guys, but to overtake is impossible. And I think it was just one or two laps that was raining, and couldn't overtake anyone, unfortunately.
Only riders can really fully understand what Mark's had to go through over these last 12 months or so. So now he's back on the top step of the podium. We know it's in the Sachsenring, a track that he does love, but how much admiration, how much respect do you have for what he's achieved today?
Full respect. He's just from another planet. Mark is, for me, at the moment, one of the best of the history. And when you missed 1 year, bad injury, a lot of operation, is amazing what he achieved today. And I'd already say to him, to many TVs already, is big congratulations and hats off for him, because he's amazing race. I mean, he was in the front of the race and Miguel was behind, but no pressure and he wins. So big congratulations.
Just looking at the championship, 22 points now clear of Johann Zarco going to Assen. Assen, we know, is a track that normally works well with a Yamaha. You certainly like Assen as well, so you must be looking confident of another podium, maybe a victory to take into the summer break and increase your championship lead as well.
Yes, honestly, looking at yesterday's pace and everything, we said, wow, the Ducatis are really strong and will be difficult to beat them. But like I said, to finish in front of them, to make a podium here, I think that is so important. And what we missed last year was not the speed, it was the consistency. And this year we have both. In a bad moments, we finish in P3. Not bad, but I mean struggling moments. So Assen is one of my favorite tracks, a track that suits really well to the Yamaha. So if the FP1 was tomorrow, I would be so happy.
Yeah, well, life's all good. If your good days are victories and your bad days like today are podiums, it can't be too bad. Congratulations, Fabio, on another great job.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks very much to Fabio Quartararo. Thanks, Matt, as well. Really summed it all up there, Simon. Did Fabio Quartararo buzzing for that third place. The added bonus, of course, of not just going to a circuit now that he loves is the fact that the two guys who did finish ahead of him at this precise moment in time are not a threat for the championship as well.
Yeah, I mean, long term, I wouldn't bet against Miguel if he keeps this role going. But yeah, you're right. You know, the thing I took from that interview as well is it's so tough out there right now. The riders are thinking, get the right start, try and get an advantage. And when it's dangerous, when there's drops falling on your visor, that's the chance you've got to pull on another guy, because the rest of it, you're so even. I mean, it's crazy, isn't it? Raindrops, that's the time to push and make a gap on the other guy, which Mark managed to do. It's truly amazing. Well, so yeah, about Fabio, he's, like I said, he's matured. He's so much more rounded as a rider. The bike is better at overall at the tracks. And yeah, unreal. I think he can go everywhere and keep doing what he's doing.
Simon, do we dare even touch on what happened on the other side of the garage at Monster Energy Yamaha today?
Oh, I don't know. I don't know what to say.
We didn't see him for a start, so I mean, we can't actually say how his race went. But I mean, obviously, we saw the starting position yesterday was just a categoric disaster from the moment he crashed and at a real crucial point
on turn FP3. One. Yeah, FP3. Maverick, as you know, is so likable. You know, he's always friendly to us, so smiley. The thing that scares me is when it starts to go bad, which it did in FP3 when he had that crash, it keeps heading that way and he struggles to turn it around. And I think it was harder at this track because the Yamaha obviously wasn't giving the riders the feel they want, the confidence, and Fabio could turn it around and Maverick couldn't, you know.
I mean,
it's a shame.
To try and sort of put a positive spin on it, because we're certainly not trying to pick on Maverick, he's very strong in Assen and he could do with a big boost result before going into the summer break, because you don't really want to go into 5 weeks, Simon, do you, with results like this?
If he feels good, if he qualifies well, I wouldn't bet against Maverick winning at Assen, you know. So, yeah.
Just sticking with Yamaha for a bit, Rossi didn't have too bad pace. He scored some points today. Franco Morbidelli, I think, was a real surprise for everyone this weekend. You mentioned it to Wilco Zeelenberg on the grid as well. A head scratcher, really, all round, because I think everybody expected Morbidelli, who notoriously has gone well at the Saxon Ring as well, to be up there.
Well, the 2019 bike, coming in here, I thought Franco's on there, and it was famous for turning well. I thought, that's what you need here. There's nowhere really for him to be at a disadvantage engine-wise, but it just didn't happen, and I have no idea why, you know. I really don't.
Moving on to the LCR Honda guys, we didn't see the start of the crash between Alex Marquez and Danilo Petrucci. Petrucci looked pretty upset. Alex didn't look like he was taking any sort of responsibility for it, so we'll have to wait until the next round. Nakagami, you spoke to Lucio Cecchinello on the grid. They gambled on the softer option rear tyre, the only rider and team combo to do that. And I think everyone was just maybe expecting Taka to be up there and attack a little more at the start, although at the same time, he's trying to keep the soft there for the end of the race. So it was almost like this, you're damned if you do, you're damned if you don't.
I think it all comes down to start. If the start's not good and you've got a... You can't take advantage of what you can do because there's someone in your way here, which is a nightmare to pass. Saxon Ring, there's one line and you're going from grass to grass. It'd be so hard to get by. So I think that's what happened. He just got mired in, couldn't take advantage of soft rear, and then that's it.
Well, it's now time to cross over to our next interview. It's three podiums on the spin. Another flawless performance from Portugal's Miguel Oliveira. The KTM rider is with Matt now.
Yeah, thanks, Steve. Another faultless and flawless performance by Miguel Oliveira. He's third in the row. Miguel, you didn't make a mistake in Mugello. You didn't make a mistake in Barcelona. We couldn't see you make a mistake today in Germany. It's no disgrace to finish second to Marc Marquez at the Saxon Ring. You tried absolutely everything you possibly could, but just came up a little bit short. You still must be super satisfied, though, with another podium.
Yes, I have to be satisfied. I made the best I could. I knew from yesterday that the starting position was not ideal. I was squeezed in on the outside of the second row, so I knew I needed to expect also the others to make a bad start. I made a fantastic start, but then I had to roll off a little bit. After that, you know, there was I was kept keeping calm a little bit in this group, trying to see a little bit the pace, warming up the tires, get it going. Finally, the drops of rain came. Mark was able to understand quite quickly how much he could push, and he risked more than the others. I got held up behind a little bit, and this was the key moment of the race. Then after, when I could get to the second place, it was already a bit late. I didn't have much left. He was in control, so I was a bit faster in some places, he was in other ones, but it was the best I could do. I really pushed hard, and he didn't put a foot wrong, me neither. And finally, it was my best was second.
It looked like Mark and the Honda were a little bit stronger in the first two sectors, and then you were stronger in sectors three and four. Where were you able to gain in those last couple of splits?
Well, I think it was down the waterfall. I was keeping a good drive in, even compared to the guys that I overtook there. I think that was a good strong point for me. And the last two corners, breaking point going into turn 12 was nice. But then I don't know, he had just a little bit more on the right-hand corners, I believe. It was nothing I could do.
At one stage, the advantage was just over 2 seconds, but we knew you were never going to give up. You were going to keep piling the pressure on. It came down to, I think, the smallest gap was 9 tenths.
Yeah.
At that stage of the race, were you confident? Did you still think that you could reel him in, or did you always think that he was managing the situation?
Well, I believe that he was in control, but still I put a lot of pressure because I thought maybe, you know, his physical condition, we never know, maybe he could start to fall back a little bit, maybe his tire could have been a little bit worse than mine, and so I was just putting in the pressure just in case, and finally didn't add anything wrong. When it came to 3 laps to go, he still had a little bit extra, and he pulled away a little bit, half a second on that lap, and I decided that was it.
I remember on Friday you said that Mark was going to be the clear favourite on Sunday, and I don't think too many people believed you, but your prediction was pretty accurate in the end.
Yeah. No, this was the best place for him to show his potential, and we always knew from the start that he was the favourite. He has a clear, incredible record here, and if he wanted to show something, here or Texas would have been the best place.
Just before I let you go, Miguel, we're moving to Aston very quickly next weekend. And what must be one of the most satisfying elements of the last couple of weeks is the fact that different circuits, Mugello, fast-flowing and technical, like Barcelona as well, and then this, completely different, very narrow, tight and twisty, but the updated KTM and you working together now seem to be working on completely different circuits, which must give you a lot of confidence moving forward into the season.
Yeah, I have to say that it's we are never relaxed. Even that we are happy that the bike is working in the different tracks. We know we can get a good base level coming into different tracks, but that doesn't make us relaxed at all. we keep working quite a lot and paying attention to every detail. We still don't have a perfect package. I don't think anyone has it at the moment, so we just need to understand with the team which is the strong points of the bike and just get out the maximum of each one of them.
Well, over the last 11 years, Miguel, there's not been too many people that have been able to remark close here in the Saxon Ring. You did it. Huge congratulations. We'll see you in a few days' time in Aston.
Yes, thank you.
Thanks, Miguel.
Yeah, thanks to Miguel Oliveira, a proper effort there, and thanks to Matt as well. Simon, you have to admire KTM greatly for the effort that they continuously put in. I know all teams do, but whenever you speak to Pitt, you can hear it in his voice as well, and their backs are up against the wall. After such a great year last year, a breakthrough year, they were up against it at the start of this season, weren't they? And they have really answered some questions in the last few races.
Big style. If you remember back to Qatar, when they didn't have the front tyre that allowed them to win, and they were really grumpy at first, and then they went, in no time at all, we've got to figure out how to use what we have got. Mm. And so they marched on and did that, bike setting wise, then came with that next chassis, didn't actually expect it to make such a good difference. And the danger is, they're one of the few that are rocking up with new chassis during the year. They've got another one coming on the way, I've heard, in the same direction, you know, to try and get more out of it, to see how it goes. The other thing I'd like to add about Miguel, just listening to him then, looking at him from a rider's point of view, he's dangerous. He's always confident, yeah, but he's never that relaxed and happy. He's confident in himself and his machine, and I'd be worried if I was racing him.
I understand.
Okay, let's go over now to cross to Matt Burt. He is with the King of the Ring. Mark Marquez is back, and he's with Matt.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Steve. The man standing in front of me, I think living proof that fairy tales really do happen. Mark, I mean, such emotional scenes after the race, 581 days since you last had this special taste of winning and standing on a podium in MotoGP Valencia 2019. After everything that you've been through, this must be one of the most special moments, not just of your career, but of your whole life.
Yeah, of course. I think I don't realize. I don't realize what I am. I mean, it was something that when I crossed the line, just I enjoyed. And when I arrived with all my team and I see that they were so emotional, of course, this helps a lot, because from a very deep situation, it's impossible to come back alone. I mean, you need the people. You need a good team of doctors, you need a good team of physio, team, Honda, respect me a lot. I mean, Alberto Puig, Emilio Zamora, my manager, my family, my brother, they helped me a lot. And yeah, we work really, really hard. It's true that in next races we will come back in our reality, but in our real situation. But now it's time to enjoy this weekend. You know, we were in a deep situation, but we were looking for a petrol station. I mean, and we find now the fuel tank again is full. So this is extra motivation for Honda, for the engineers too, for the riders, and yeah, let's see in the future. But you know,
I forget in the circuit where I was. I forget everything. Just I was riding, and when I crossed the line, it was a very nice feeling.
I'm sure that petrol station was a Repsol petrol station. Mark, talk us through the race. The crucial moment was when those rain spots started to fall. You're already in the lead, having made a couple of good passes on Aleix Espargaró, and then we know you're so good at judging the conditions, certainly in the past, and you made that crucial break of about 1.5 seconds. Was that the key moment for you? You thought, right, now is my chance.
Of course, when I see some drops on the screen, I say, okay, now is my time. I mean, because you know, we are struggling with the grip, so with some drops on the racetrack, the grip is the same for us. So then I keep the same race pace. I just slow down a bit for the take care about the front, but I was riding in the same way, so that gap was enough in the end because Miguel was faster than me today. For all the race, normal conditions, he was a bit faster, but I was able to manage well. I was able to keep concentrated during all the race. It was difficult to take the risk or to take that mentality because I'm coming from 3 crashes in a row. So this was, I'm human and affect. But I believe in me, and I was pushing. I lead all the race, all the laps, so this is also something nice.
I think at one stage you were 2 seconds clear, and Miguel, and normally in the Saxon Ring, everybody thinks that's it, job done. Mark is going to win easily. Then the gap came down to, I think, just 9 tenths. At that stage, were you confident that you were going to be able to manage the situation, or did you start to have a little few nervous moments that Miguel was coming?
Yeah, I mean, in one moment of the race, I say, okay, he will catch me. But then I say, okay, keep going, keep going. And then every time I was pushing more in T1. I know that T1 was my fastest sector and T3 was his fastest sector. So in T3, I just tried to survive a bit, and in T1, I was pushing more and more. And then, yeah, I had a little bit more on T4, but then the risk also was there. And yeah, when the tires dropped a lot, and I was struggling a lot, but I saw that his lap times also were not fantastic. So I was able to manage in a good way.
Somebody who's been in a similar position to you, a Repsol Honda rider in the past, was Mick Doohan, who came back from injuries that people thought might unfortunately finish his career. I know that you spoke to Mick in Mugello a couple of races ago, and I think you've had some other conversations. What sort of advice or inspiration or motivation was Mick able to give you over these last difficult months?
Yeah, when you are in a difficult situation, you try to find the help from somewhere. And then Alberto Puig helped me a lot, all my team helps me a lot, all my family, my manager, but the person that was in a similar situation was Mick Doohan. So in Mugello, I speak a little bit with him, but then I say, I bribe him and after the race, and I say, I want to have a phone call with you. And we had a phone call, and just was 30 minutes phone call. Just he was speaking, and I was listening. And my question was, which was your feeling and your problems 92, 93? And then he explained everything, and it was like he was saying the same problems, exactly same problems, same feeling what I have now. I mean, difficult to understand the bike, difficult to understand the riding style, stupid mistakes, stupid crash, and all these things is what I'm doing. He say in some race you will be fast, some race very slow. So you know, when somebody, some legend like Mick, that was an animal on the bike, he suffered, but he come back in the future. This gives to you a good confidence to keep working.
Amazing words, Mark, and I'm sure I speak for millions of MotoGP fans all around the world in saying it is absolutely awesome to see you back winning in MotoGP and on the top step of the podium again. Huge congratulations and huge respect after the journey that you've been on. Well done, Mark.
Thank you very much. Thank you, and thank you for all the fans that understand the situation, that this rider, is really important.
Thanks, Mark, and back to you guys, Steve.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Matt. Thank you so much, Mark. What a moment. What words?
Oh, absolutely brilliant, you know. Watching, I hope everyone else saw what machines these guys are. Mm. You know, the determination, the skill, the calculations, you know, because they're huge calculations of risk, you know, deciding to push when that raindrops came down, when he went after everything he's been through. And like I said, that's when he made that gap. To do all that, you know, I mean, for example, I mean, there must be F1 fans watching, you know, and those guys are the same, how they have to calculate it. But the risk here in the sport, and he still manages to do it, I think, astounding, like, what a machine.
I cannot add to that. Simon, thanks as ever for your comments. Thanks to Matt Burt. Thanks for everyone for tuning in this weekend. We will be back in a few days at the Dutch TT in Assen. But for now, we'll leave you with highlights. The comeback kid and still king of the ring, Marc Márquez, is back.
The German Grand Prix is underway, and it's a rocket start there on the outside for Zarco, but Quartararo's coming through. It might well be Aleix Bagnaia. Márquez has got at the inside line as well. He's up to second. Márquez is going to try and fight back through at turn 13. Márquez leads here in Germany. Here he comes up the inside. He's now up to second again. Comes Quartararo, the Frenchman, the championship leader then. He's in third. The checkered flag is out. Still the king of the ring. Marc Márquez wins here in Germany.
581 days since his last victory. And he is back.